Doing things together, that's what family's all about. Building memories, like watching movies together. That's become a thing we do now more than ever with Disney Blu-ray. My family cannot believe how real the picture looks and the amazing sound. It feels like you're part of the movie.
Merry Christmas!
One of the best things Blu-ray offers is all the fun activities my family can play and explore together. Not to mention Blu-ray discs are kid-proof and more scratch-resistant. Plus, your Blu-ray player plays both Blu-ray discs and all your favorite DVDs. And now there's an even greater value than ever before with the Disney Blu-ray Combo Pack. It includes a DVD so we can share the movie experience on the go, wherever we go. Experience how Disney Blu-ray can help you create new memories.
And now, look for all these new family favorites on Disney Blu-ray Combo Packs. A great value that includes a DVD copy of the movie. And coming soon, look for the new Blu-ray Combo Packs with 3D, available on Disney's A Christmas Carol and Alice in Wonderland. Learn more at DisneyBlu-ray3D.com.
Get my nose right. Aha!
Rider!
Enjoy prison! I'll miss the sound of your laughter. Ah, alone at last. Listen, I didn't want to have to do this, but you leave me no choice. Here comes the smolder. You coming, Blondie?
Christmas, the most magical time of the year. And the best Christmas I remember is the one where I became Santa's best friend. Truth is, it almost didn't happen.
Without Santa's magic crystal, he could become mortal.
So, can you start today?
What kind of work is it exactly?
In-store Santa. I need help finding Santa Claus.
Hi, we'll do this together, Lottie.
Bud is so amazing. The kids are just drawn to him.
She wanted me to get a puppy to cheer up the girls in the foster home.
Who knows what kind of trouble Santa Claus and Paws are in?
I don't know if I'm the real Santa Claus or not.
This place could use some Christmas cheer. Hi! Can you imagine a world without Santa Claus?
Someone once told me that the spirit of Christmas is embodied in the hearts of children.
Ho, ho, ho! Merry Christmas!
Every day a prince is born.
They call me Thumper.
Gosh.
pick it.
He doesn't walk very good, does he?
My little Bambi.
Advanced technology, the most exotic locations, the most dangerous assignments. Next summer, get ready to roll with the world's newest secret agents.
Mater?
I think we bit off more than we could chew.
the power of the potato to tell time. Rex, how are we doing?
It's 1:30 his eyeball!
Impressive!
This is ridiculous.
What's going on, fellas?
Us? We're just making a potato clock.
Ah, yes. The vegetable acts as an electrochemical battery, converting chemical energy into electricity by spontaneous electron transfer.
Yeah, you can do it that way.
I'm out of here.
Have you no love of science? Buzz, how do you know so much about electrochemistry?
Well, I saw hundreds of experiments while I was aboard the International Space Station.
Oh,
wow.
Yeah, let me show you.
Buzz Lightyear, Mission Logs, Episode 3, The Science of Adventure.
Ooh, cool.
Look at that.
What are they doing, Buzz?
Scientific experimentation. A noble pursuit, indeed.
Amazing.
Wow. What other kind of experiments do they do?
Well, they also test new technologies, grow plants in space, experiment with bacteria and plasma. They even do research about the impact of microgravity on humans.
Human experimentation?
It's not like that. On the ISS, everyone participates in a series of experiments studying how humans respond to life in space. How we can help them stay healthy now and on future space expeditions.
Wow, that's a lot of experiments. But why do we have to do them up there?
Well, by doing experiments on the ISS, you change one very important variable, gravity.
Ooh.
That variable can mean big changes to scientific outcomes.
Hey, what you doing there?
Earth science. Right now, we're tracking the polar icebergs that broke away from Antarctica.
Antarctica?
Ah, that's a nice view from up there.
It's a great view. You can see everything from orbit 220 miles above the Earth.
That's pretty high up. How fast did you say you were going?
Oh, just 17,500 miles per hour.
Wow!
That's super fast! How did you ever get down from there?
Very carefully. You can take either the Russian Soyuz capsule to Kazakhstan or the American space shuttle to Cape Canaveral. I took the shuttle. The descent process is pure physics. When the shuttle detaches, it's still orbiting the Earth at 17,500 miles per hour, just like the ISS. In order to get out of orbit, the shuttle has to slow down a lot.
Oh, you really gotta slam on those brakes, huh?
Brakes don't work in space, Ham.
I knew that.
Those clever NASA scientists, physicists, and engineers designed a way for the space shuttle to slow down using a combination of friction and reverse power.
Discovery, you are go for the deorbit burn.
Discovery copies, go for the
deorbit
burn.
Whoa.
What the? What was that?
Well, when the shuttle cuts through the atmosphere, it's still going faster than the speed of sound, so it creates
a sonic boom. I read about that on the NASA website.
Runway in sight, Houston.
Discovery, we copy.
When we touch down, it's still going over 200 miles an hour. Luckily, there's a parachute to slow us down.
Yay, Buzz! You're home!
Welcome home, Discovery. Congratulations on an extremely successful mission, stepping up science to a new level on the International Space Station.
Mission accomplished!
Oh, our mission didn't end there, Ham. Soon, I was called away to test the atmosphere in a strange and magnificent land inhabited by giant mice. They called it Disney World.
What the?
Cool.
Experiments in microgravity, Earth science from a spaceship, the physics of a shuttle descent, and giant mice? What a trip!
It's like a dream.
It's no dream, Rex. It takes all kinds of scientists, physicists, astronauts, giant mice, and many others to make these dreams a reality.
You guys were right about this science thing.
I've got my own experiment.
Great. What is it?
How to make a pig fly.
Hey, what's going on? Hey, what are you doing?
Tell us what the weather's like!
For more science, visit this NASA website.
Oh, look at me. I'm an astro pig.
My name is Ken Schretzman. I'm a film editor on Toy Story 3.
My name is Robert Graham Jones. I'm a film editor here at Pixar. When film editors are working, they call it cutting because it comes out of the tradition of physically cutting film.
The film is made in pieces. It's made in close-ups and wide shots and different angles. Someone has to make the choice of how these pieces go together.
My name is Steve Bloom. I'm an editor.
My name is Jeannie Applegate. I'm an assistant editor at Pixar.
There's a lot of trial and error.
You usually have more than you need to work with, and you kind of have to get down to the real heart of the scene.
Editing is really about storytelling. The goal is to find the story and find the way to tell it in the most efficient and entertaining way possible. The most common question I ask myself when cutting is, do we really need this? Can we say it in a look? Can we do these two things at the same time? What can we throw out? What can we combine? What can we add?
Editorial is like a melting pot. Animation, layout, story, lighting, and we get to put it all together.
I am Torben Bullock. I am a motion picture editor here at Pixar.
My name is Renee Steen. I'm an assistant film editor. It seems like every day, every month, every year, the movie changes, and you see all the different stages, and I don't know, I love that.
So there's a certain kind of personality that gravitates towards editorial, that likes data and creativity and technique and technology in this kind of never-ending, organized chaos mess.
This isn't a tool I use now. This is a tool I used when I first got excited about making movies. My brother bought this for $6 at a police auction. You wind it up, and then it can shoot movies. And then my brother flicked it up, and we realized this camera can take one frame at a time. And you know what that means? That means you can animate.
My name is Lee Unkrich. My first job at Pixar was as an editor on the original Toy Story, and I am now the director of Toy Story 3. The editor in a live-action film is very reactive. They're reactive to whatever the director happened to catch with the camera on the set. Mistakes and all, the editor needs to take that footage and try to make something great out of it. In animation, we can create kind of a rough draft version of the movie using the storyboards and temporary dialogue and music. And if I, as the editor, want a close-up of a character, I can just talk to the director about it. As a result, the editor has a degree of control over the filmmaking that an editor in live action would never have.
Editorial in general, and Pixar is no exception, is one of the last kind of remaining apprenticeship systems, I think, in the film business.
My first job on film was an apprentice editor on a TV movie.
I was an assistant editor for several editors, most of them out of New York.
I was a PA.
I felt like they taught me everything I needed to know on that job, how to, you know, handle film, how to rewind it, how to splice it.
One of the editors I work with is very cerebral. He'll think about making a cut for hours, whereas other editors just try 100 things just very fast.
Well, we use a lot of tools in editorial, but the main thing that I use every day are my notebooks. Every time I learn something new, I immediately write it down. I'm Bradley Furnish, second assistant editor. These are my brains.
Editorial's the hub. Everything comes in and out of editorial. Hundreds of thousands of pieces of media flying in and out. You have to sort them, organize them, export them, color code them, anything you can. My name is Anna Walitsky. I started at Pixar on Toy Story 2 as a production assistant, and now I'm editing on Toy Story 3.
There's a great reward in starting with pieces and putting it together in a way that takes it to a different level. It requires a certain amount of complete honesty that you can't just hope that something's working. It has to really work, and you have to be able to admit that it's not so you can continue and fix it.
You know, we remake the film so many times. The very first version of the film, it's temporary.
I know I can put together a good scene and I put a lot of effort into it. But at the same time, I have to be willing to, once I finish cutting it, be willing to let it go immediately.
So yeah, I think editing is in large part about letting go of things you care deeply about in order to make a better film.
When we moved into the new building, you know, everybody's doing all this cool stuff with their cubes. Some people are building shacks and things looking like, you know, they're out in the Wild West, like a mining camp. So I moved into this office and there's like a little tiny door and it had a key in it. I opened that door and there was this air conditioning access vent. It opened up into this huge space. I just thought, wow, how cool would it be to build like a secret spot? So it started with just Christmas lights. And then I was putting fur in there, like faux fur, pillows and shelving units. I put a camera in there so I could see if anyone was coming. One day, Andrew Stanton was on a walkthrough for Nemo, I think it was. He was like, where's Gordon? And so I was in there. And so he stuck his head in. Like, I thought I was gonna get fired, you know, or something, or get in trouble, or, you know, something. And he was like, oh, cool. And then he started showing up with John Lasseter, and then John Lasseter, of course, loved it. And then famous people started showing up. So I'd be sitting in my office. Hey, Andrew, we're coming to the office. And it would be like big Hollywood stars, famous musicians, world-famous photographers, sports stars, directors, legendary animators, you know, you name it. They would all want to come in and have a drink. I mean, I would be working. And then Steve Jobs and John Lasseter would show up. You know, and I was like the host. I had a jacket. I had my little fez, like a martini mixer. There was like a whole band in there once where they did a whole performance. There was a whole entire soccer team in there at one time. And then you'd have like big wigs come in. But it was like this place that they had to bring people. It was strange because everybody had to crawl through. It was just an awkward position to be in. Some of the stories I heard were pretty unbelievable. Those walls could talk, it'd be really something to hear.
I give a tour of Pixar. Mandatory, the first stop is the best room at Pixar. It's not our world-class theater. It's not the amazing render farm. It's not even John Lasseter's phenomenal toy collection. Nope, none of these. It's the room where we keep the cereal.
Pixar has a cereal bar. Not just any cereal bar. It has the grand daddy of cereal bars. And cereal has definitely played an interesting and integral part of how we make our movies at Pixar.
Cereal bar is like this big, long row of almost every kind of cereal you can imagine.
It is made of high-quality plexiglass with the finest decal labels. We range from Grape Nuts to Muesli, and then down to Captain Crunch, Cinnamon Toast Crunch, Cocoa Puffs, all the childhood vices.
And it does sort of give you that same glee of standing in the cereal aisle, doesn't it? Something magical about that.
So there's people eating cereal in meetings. There are people eating cereal at their desks. There are people eating cereal in screening rooms. You even see people eating cereal on scooters.
It kind of makes sense that we fueled these films with vast amount of free cereal. Makes sense.
Animators are the actors in the studio.
In most cases, animation departments will do something off-kilter towards the end of the production.
Competitions, or building crazy offices, or having wild parties that have a theme.
So instead of kind of doing something at the end, we decided to start it off with a bang.
We're going to shave our heads and our beards down to the skin as a way to have a clean start.
It was a clean start.
A clean start.
Clean start. And Lee, he had this long, flowing mane of hair. It was like a black stallion.
That became a target for the animators.
We're like, Lee, come on, what do you think? You know, this would be great. Shave your head with us, you know, bonding. And he was like, no. So we made a big spectacle out of it. And there's nothing that rallies the troops, and there's nothing that can suck your director in than spectacle.
The way it felt down there, you could hear the drum beat, you know, shave your head, shave your head. You think, sure, I want to be one of them. I want to be accepted. And you could see animators who weren't thinking they were going to cut their hair stepping up.
And we're like,
Lee, Lee, Lee.
And he would inch a little closer, and he would inch a little closer. And then finally, he sat down in the chair. Took the clippers, had this gorgeous head of hair. Then what you had to do, you were supposed to not cut your hair or shave your beard.
And the last man standing is the winner of something. And I remember Lee was just like, I'm not going to give up. You guys are going to look ridiculous, but I'm going to win. We went for, I don't even know how many weeks.
And slowly people would drop off. They just couldn't handle it anymore. My beard outgrew my hair at a ratio of like 3 to 1. I was a looker.
We all started to look like crazy people.
I was like, I can't do this anymore.
Bobby brokered a deal where we would all shave our faces.
We decided each day you could take off one section of facial hair. So we got some insanely crazy looks all through this week as we were taking pieces off. Part of the hijinks that goes on in animation is the sense that we're all in this together.
I don't think the movies would be nearly as good if we didn't feed the creativity with some extracurricular fun.
How many toys are in this film?
The number of characters of the movie is particularly high.
I don't even know what the final count was.
How many? No. Because there's so many, right?
I mean, they're definitely over 100.
150 plus characters in it?
I think it's over 200 characters.
1,297 toys in this film. Nah, I have no idea.
New toys!
Well, there's some funny challenges I didn't expect. I thought we'd just open up the box and there's Buzz, okay, and there's Woody, and you would make the movie. But we had to rebuild all the characters. The technology has changed, grown, evolved since Toy Story, Toy Story 2. So we're rebuilding Buzz and Woody. I thought we didn't have to do that.
We went into the old models because we still had them, and we examined them like doing archaeology in a way. We'd go into the old shading code and see Eben Ospie's name, Bill Reeves, Ed Catmull, people whose papers we used to read in university. And when you have to recreate them, you realize how much craftsmanship really went into it. We didn't have to do a lot for Toy Story 3. We had to just kind of be true to what was already there.
When we saw the first animation test, and when we saw the first teaser, where everybody's, oh my God, they're back again, they're back live again.
Didn't I tell you it'd look great, huh? Oh, Buzz, where the heck have you been?
We met in the screening room with John Lasseter and Lee Unkrich to figure out what exactly we wanted to make sure we kept about old Buzz and sort of changed subtly for new Buzz. Old Buzz's brows have 3 controls each. Our new brows that we've done for the past few films, each brow has about 20 to 25 controls. So we actually chopped out a lot of the controls that we would ordinarily put into a human and limited it to a much smaller subset so that it was closer to what we had on classic Buzz.
Estoy rodeado por criaturas extrañas y desconozco.
There's a particular moment in Toy Story 3 where Buzz is Spanish Buzz.
My name is Carlos Baena. I'm an animator on Toy Story 3, and I was mostly responsible for animating Buzz in his Spanish mode. One of the things in Buzz when he's in Spanish mode that I've been playing with a lot is doing things that are unexpected.
¿Han visto mi nave espacial?
His attitude drives from flamenco dancers, where everything is very powerful.
We looked at a lot of video of bullfighters and Latin ballroom dancing. Carlos went off on his own.
I try a lot of different things. I shot a bunch of reference by myself. I'll draw it as a roadmap.
And he put together this animation test. Everybody loved it, and in a moment we knew who Spanish Buzz was.
Look!
What is it?
When the toys donate themselves to Sunnyside, they have a vision of what it's going to be. I always described it as being like a Boca Raton retirement home. Like they're just gonna live their lives forever and be happy. And it's fun to then see the rug get pulled out from under them and have it turn out to be not such a great place.
Lotso's gang, they're bad guys. You know, really they're a gang.
They need to be the heavies so they can't feel dinky. They need to be strong.
Each character in that gang had to have a purpose.
So you've got Stretch, the octopus, and she can scuttle up walls and go across the ceiling.
Big Baby is this big tattooed thug.
Chunk. He's not very smart, but he's all about muscle.
Twitch, action figure, bug, mutant, muscle guy.
Ken has the body we all wish we had.
Lasso's in charge because he's the smartest in the group.
You lost, little doggy?
Lasso is this plush toy, which is a stuffed animal. Furry, stuffed with material. He's a little bit older.
You could tell this thing's been slobbered on. It's been kicked, pulled, tugged, covered with a blanket.
We knew that in the final film, we wanted Lasso to be believably a plush figure. We wanted to have a sense of his construction. So we brought in a toy designer, somebody who had worked specifically with plush toys.
I brought a bunch of stuff to show you as far as materials, yeah. We would think in terms of extraordinarily simple shapes.
We gave him the model and said, where would you cut the pieces of fabric to be able to stitch this together? And so he drew on our sculpt, and that's exactly how we built him.
We had a series of plush Lassos made, and those early plush prototypes were very important for us because they helped inform the further design of him. But it was also great for the animators.
So when he walks, you want to see these wrinkles. It's weird because a soft plush bear doesn't weigh much, but you want him to feel like someone he's got a cane, he's got a little weight to him.
If you start at the bottom, pay your dues, life here can be a dream come true.
What was interesting to us was analyzing the reasons why he was the way he was. And when we came up with this notion of a toy being lost and then going through all these obstacles to make his way back home only to discover that he had just been callously replaced, it felt very toy-like. I mean, it's important. If you're going to be in this world of toys, you want to give the toys problems that aren't human problems. You want them to be toy problems.
She don't love you no more. Now come on!
It's always awesome when you see a character being made. You're working on them and you kind of have an idea of what they look like. But when someone else takes them, they have their own perception. And that's the beauty of it.
It was a great responsibility. I knew that there were going to be really high expectations for this film and I didn't want to disappoint anybody. And at the same time, I knew I was also creating new characters that were going to become part of this storied universe.
Just the way you're getting these kind of creases in here.
It was really fulfilling to work on characters on Toy Story 3 and add to the legacy of Toy Story 1 and 2.
They're fantastic.
Oh, I'm glad you like them.
Yeah,
that's it.
I love them.
I've been working on a Pixar movie on and off for about a long time. This is a big moment for an actor in an animated movie. I have four kids, but when I started doing this, I think I only had two. Actually, I did. I only had two kids when I started doing this, but it's been the most pleasant experience.
I'm getting a little weepy. Toy Story 3, our little picture.
Toy Story characters have been in our hearts and minds after all these years. We've been thinking about it, wanting to do Toy Story 3 for so long.
The toys have just become really iconic characters, and it has to do with a lot of factors. I mean, they're really funny, interesting characters, but the people that voice them, the actors that voice those characters, were also a big part of making those characters great.
I know they're doing great. And you can help out once in a while because you need the money.
We invited all the core actors back from the classic characters. It was great. It was like a reunion.
It's been 15 years since the first Toy Story.
You look good, Woody. You look good.
It's nice that Pixar and Disney brought everybody together. There's a comfort to it. It's a family comfort.
Come back to a lovely, familiar, happy place.
We've been so fortunate that the talent in all of our films, and in particular the Toy Story films, are just a part of us. They're family. And on this film, we cast a whole slew of new characters.
There is no way out of here.
Just kidding. Door's right over there.
Buttercup is played by Jeff Garlin. There's Dolly, who's played by Bonnie Hunt.
Buzz. Oh, that's interesting.
Is that Icelandic?
We have Trixie the Triceratops, played by the delightful Kristen Schaal.
Hello, I'm Trixie.
We have Mr. Pricklepants, played by the dashing Timothy Dalton.
Well, excuse me. I'm trying to stay in character.
Stretch the purple glittery octopus, voiced by Whoopi Goldberg.
What did you expect from a girl's toy?
I'm not a girl's toy! I'm not! Why do you guys keep saying that?
Ken is played by the amazingly talented Michael Keaton.
And being Ken is about having fun!
Lee and I were blown away by how much energy and improv and passion he brought to that part.
Groovy, huh?
Yeah. Ken has good genes. That happened to look great in jeans.
Well, hello there.
And then finally, we have Lotso. He's played by Ned Beatty, who's a fantastic character actor, kind of a national treasure in the acting community.
I feel really wonderful about being a part of this film. I can't express that too much.
I knew he would be great for Lotso because not only has he done a lot of comedy in his career, but he's also done a lot of really great dramatic roles, and I kind of needed both.
Now bring a little bit of your drawl back
in. Okay, a little more drawl. He knew what he wanted. It was a question sometimes of finding just the right dialect.
We decided to give him this kind of New Orleans drawl because we thought it just made him that much more relaxed and laid back and trustworthy.
Lotso basically sounds like he lives uptown in New Orleans. I thought I heard new voices. Welcome to Sunnyside, folks. I'm Lotso Huggin' Bear.
That's awesome. Part of our process in making Toy Story 3 is the same way that people have been making animated features back since Snow White, and that's that we create an elaborate story reel.
They just showed us the entire animatic, and it lasted exactly as long as the movie itself.
They showed it in storyboards, very rudimentary. I thought, story's so good, we all got emotional over that one.
And gradually, different elements are replaced, like the real actors' voices get put in.
Come on, guys. Let's get our parts together, get ready, and go out on a high note.
I'd better find my other eye.
Where'd you leave it this time?
Someplace dark and dusty. I didn't even work with Don Rickles. We do our lines individually, not as a group.
And you don't get the whole script. You just get your pages.
So we only know what our lines mean at that particular scene.
So this is you making your getaway. You've just robbed a train.
And we're thrilled.
And you're thrilled, and you're kind of this ninja warrior, right? That's why you did all that.
Okay. And we have Lee, our director, who explains the whole story and plays all of the characters.
Try a little less, like, breathy. She's sounding a little Marilyn Monroe-ish.
Oh, we don't want that.
Voiceover work, I think, is so great because things are happening around you and you can't see it, so you have to imagine it. And then you also have to make your voice and emotion match what's happening in the scene. So you really have to exercise your imagination muscle.
Oh, that's just a velociraptor toy down the street. Oh, that's just a velociraptor toy down the street. Oh, that's just a dinosaur toy down the street. That's nothing.
It's an incredibly complex process. There's whole days that you have to just do grunting and panting and breathing.
A nose sigh right here. That's what it says.
I heard that was your specialty.
I'm guessing that is a...
Could you do it a little wetter? There you go.
Sorry.
Awesome.
Up.
Where's this switch? I love these characters. I helped make Toy Story and Toy Story 2. And so for me, it was like coming home again. It was like working with old friends. The only character that we had to recast, unfortunately, was Slinky Dog.
Slink, gather everyone up.
We are gathered, Woody.
Because Jim Varney passed away right after we made Toy Story 2. But we've recast him with a really talented actor named Blake Clark, who very much captures the essence and spirit of Slinky Dog's character.
Well, how you doing?
I just wanted to do right by the role and do right by Jim. We were friends. I met him in 1980. I was working the door at the Comedy Store. And he's from Kentucky and I'm from Georgia. And so we just kind of hit it off. We did a movie together.
Ah, who are we kidding? The kid's 17 years old.
Yeah, we ain't ever getting played with.
I tried a picture in my mind, Jim, when I was doing the voice and try to, you know, talk like Jim. What time is it? Zorro, why don't you make some fudge?
Andy threw us out.
Okay.
Awesome.
You know, Lee took me really by surprise, and I kind of choked up. He said, I think Jim would have been proud, so I didn't see that coming, and I got tears in my eyes. Jim was he's a good guy. Funny. Very, very funny man.
So you're Bonnie? I'm Andy. Someone told me you're really good with toys.
One of the decisions that I made very early on in this film was to reach out to John Morris, the actor who had played young Andy in Toy Story and Toy Story 2. We didn't know where he was. We didn't know if he was still acting. We didn't know if he'd even be interested or if he'd even sound right. But we got his phone number, and we called, and he didn't answer, but we got his answering machine. And the moment I heard his voice on the answering machine, I thought, hallelujah, he sounds great. He still sounds young.
And this is Buzz Lightyear, the coolest toy ever made. Look, look, he can fly.
The first Toy Story I auditioned for when I was 7. I've been involved in these films for 17 years, which is the vast majority of my life. And so it's quite profound.
So we brought John in from very early on and started working with him and recording the beginnings of what became the Goodbye Andy scene at the end of the movie.
This is Jessie, the roughest, toughest cowgirl in the whole West.
And he was very emotional for John, too, because he, you know, he's grown now. You know, he's in his early 20s and has gone to college and moved on in his life. And, you know, for him, this is about change and a passage as well. I think this whole experience was very resonant for him.
It is bittersweet. It's very emotional. And it's been very emotional recording it to say goodbye to them. And to say goodbye to years and years of love and play and connection and devotion.
Okay, now you gotta promise to take really good care of these guys. They mean a lot to me.
It was a major responsibility to make Toy Story 3, to bring these characters back to life again. But rather than being intimidated by it, I just completely embraced it.
The very last shot of the movie.
Oh.
Is all of our characters.
What?
Look under your boot, Woody.
That's my line.
You too, Jessie. This is a great relationship because there's just an element of respect for each other and mirrored in a relationship I've got with Hank.
You got like 6 words in this one.
Thank you for pointing that out, Tom.
Well, it's official. You guys made the wall.
You know, I've been so fortunate to do so many things in my career, but I can say that I'm the most proud of the association with Pixar. My favorite place to work. I'm just honored to be a part of it.
This is such a collaborative art form. The actor's voice infused into the process is very, very fascinating. So what they bring to it is soul. They bring in their soul and their talent, and they breathe this beautiful life into these characters.
And what's great is I get credit for it sometimes, you know, because I've been the voice of Woody for lo these many years. Kids that are in college coming up to me and they say, boy, you know, when you told that neighbor kid in Toy Story 1 to play nice, that really meant a lot to me. It was my voice. I wasn't really the... I'll take the credit.
They're timeless pieces. I mean, they're classics, and they're going to be around forever. After I laid my voice down, and I was like, well, I guess I'm immortal now. You know?
From the very first time we met Buzz and Woody in the first Toy Story, everyone wanted to go somewhere with them.
We talked about how to get the Toy Story toys into the Disney theme parks.
Buzz Lightyear Astro Blasters was one of the first projects that involved the Toy Story characters.
You spin around 360 degrees and you blast at, you know, enemy aliens. So it's just great fun.
When we were starting to think about a new interactive attraction for Disney's California Adventure, we came up with Toy Story Mania. Toy Story Mania began as an idea of playing traditional Midway games with the Toy Story characters. So we picked from the Midway game series the typical games, and we wanted it to feel like a three-dimensional digital real world.
There was an opportunity
in the second park, the studio park in Paris, that they wanted to do a new kind of land. So the idea came out, what if it was like Andy was playing with his toys in his backyard?
It was something that would appeal to guests of all ages, to a very broad audience. It was colorful, it was kinetic, it alters your perception of scale, and it was a very immersive environment that we thought would work really well for Hong Kong as well.
There are a lot of steps that take us from the initial concept all the way to opening day. We begin with sketches, begin to build scale models, animation models, and small-scale maquettes, and then we built them in full-size.
And then we did what's called a SketchUp model, which is a 3D computer model, and that helps us as we start to go through the land, and it gives us the perspective from our point of view. Especially in a land like Toy Story, where everything is over scale, understanding the composition and how those scales play to human size really helps us get into those environments.
From the time we began clearing the site, it's 18 to 20 months of infield construction before we're ready to open the park. Buzz Lightyear greets you at the front of the land, and he's 14 feet tall. And on the blocks, you can literally walk under him.
Everything from the landscaping, we have grasses and bamboos that also helps to support that shift in scale. All of the elements, the rides, the character icons or photo opportunities are all oversized. So as soon as you walk into that land, you feel like you're the size of a toy.
So we took a look at all these different cool ride systems and we thought, what could they be like, you know, in themed with Toy Story? And we love the Green Army Men. And we thought, oh, wouldn't it be awesome to have, you know, those fantastic parachute rides? They ride up and drop down. They are so much fun. And we thought, this is like perfect because the Army Man and the parachutes are part of the original film.
The guests go through the Quonset hut and through the transportation area before they board onto their parachutes. And we take them up to the top and teach them how to jump.
There's another ride that we love where you ride on this kind of like a caterpillar or something that goes in a circle, and Slinky Dog. We just looked at it and said, it is Slinky Dog. So we developed this fantastic ride that Slinky Dog is chasing his tail, and where you sit is in his slinky coils.
The ride itself really goes around in a circle. There's a little bit of a, you know, a wonkiness to it as you're riding, but still very, very family friendly.
Slinky speeds up, slows down, does a few little things like that, and it's really very charming.
I grew up with Hot Wheels, and I just love Hot Wheels, and that's why they're in Toy Story, where Buzz Lightyear lands on the Red Baron and goes through the loops and goes off the jump. So we started looking at what can we do with RC car, and we thought, wow, we can make that car, that vehicle, look like RC, and we said, what if it's going on kind of a Hot Wheels track?
RC Racer is in the middle of all the action in the film, all the thrills, so of course that makes for more of a thrill ride. It's probably the most intense thrill ride of all three in the park.
And the track itself, it is 25 meters tall on either end, and you're launched up the half pipe, and you hang for a few seconds before you come back down. It's terrifying fun. It's the kind of thing where you think, oh my gosh, can I really do that? And once you do, you want to go on it again.
I think it appeals to the kids and all of us then to be a toy and be able to play with the toys in the Toy Story world.
Disney File Digital Copy sets you free. Now, you can watch your favorite Disney movies whenever and wherever you want.
Are you ready for this?
When you buy a special edition Disney DVD or Blu-ray with Disney File, simply take the Disney File disc, insert it into your computer, and follow the easy on-screen instructions.
Manuel, relay instructions.
In just minutes, the transfer to your computer or video-enabled portable device is complete.
Bye-bye.
Your Disney movie is ready to go.
I feel alive!
Wherever you go.
Wow.
Quick, fun, and easy. Disney File digital copy. Your favorite movies anytime, anywhere, in just minutes.
Awesome!
To find out more, visit DisneyFile.com. Look for Disney File digital copy in these and other special editions of your favorite Disney Blu-ray and DVDs.
To telling tall tales.
I was a famous bulldozer fighter in Spain.
Hola!
Señor Matador!
There's none greater than Mater.
I used to be a monster truck wrestler.
Drop and give me 20.
I'll give you 3.
1, 2, 3. I'll win her.
For the first time ever on Blu-ray and DVD.
Hey, look, a UFO.
Mater, that was a hubcap.
Disney Pixar presents Mater's Tall Tales.
If I'm lying, I'm crying.
A new collection of 9 hilarious short films.
Remain calm.
Oh, wow.
Starring the world's most famous tow truck and Lightning McQueen.
Let's have us a little look-see.
You're a doctor, too?
That's right, buddy. I got my MD, PhD, my STP, and my GTO.
Hey, doctor.
With 2 new shorts you can only see on Blu-ray and DVD.
Cool.
And a tank full of bonus features.
Whoa. Are you ready to rock?
Oh, yeah!
Disney Pixar's Mater's Tall Tales. New on Blu-ray combo pack and DVD.
That did not happen.
Did so?
Did not.
Did so?
No, Mater.
Yes, I did.
What is it? Who are you? What do you want? My God, you've gotten fat. Come in, come.
Prepare yourself for my greatest creation. A stunning debut, darling, on Blu-ray for the very first time. With a picture so fabulous, your entertainment system will weep with electronic joy. My God! Pull yourself together! With sounds so fierce, it will scare mediocrity away forever!
Let's do that again.
Bonus features to die for. Why are we so generous? Why, I ask you, why?
Showtime.
Disney Pixar's The Incredibles.
It will be bold, dramatic,
yeah.
Heroic.
For the first time ever on Blu-ray.
Darling, Blu-ray is the new black-ray.
Night, Woody. Good night, Deputy.
When night falls, what do you suppose toys dream about? Perhaps they drift off to wild and wondrous places. They come to life in song and dance on amazing stages. And they invite you to take aim and ride. And they all join together in a musical, magical parade where the fun goes on and on until you have to wonder, was it all a dream or a dream come true?
blah, 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 blah. Blah, 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 blah. Blah, 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 blah.
Thank you. Thank you.